Ferdinand is a 1923, June 13th, 1923, Lloyd Loar Gibson Mandolin. And it's just a rare bird, very unique instrument. I've seen a lot of Lloyd Loar mandolins. This is probably the cleanest Lloyd Loar mandolin I've ever seen. It's in basically mint condition. Hadn't been played probably in, well, this is 2022, 99 years at this point. He had it, played it for about a year. Ferdinand Peck was the original owner, and he lived in Ogden, Utah, near Salt Lake City. And he had purchased this mandolin. He'd either ordered it directly from Gibson, from what I gather, or got it in a local music store there in Salt Lake City. Ferdinand was a jeweler by trade, and he was, from what I gather, a pretty eccentric guy. He had a large collection of exotic birds, things like that. He liked to collect unique and rare things. So he ended up with this Lloyd Loar mandolin, new at the time. And he learned one song on the mandolin, and he played that song over and over until he basically drove his wife crazy. And she told him, look, you've got to stop playing that song. And he put it under the bed, and that's where the mandolin's been for about 98, 99 years until I got it in at the end of February in 2022. The mandolin's all original except for the truss rod cover. The truss rod cover is one that he handmade. It's very ornate. Being a jeweler, it's absolutely beautiful. It's silver. And he put the Gibson in it, and then his initials FP for Ferdinand Peck. And then the tailpiece is the original Gibson tailpiece, but he took the Gibson off of it and put Ferd P. Peck in blue enamel. That's what the truss rod cover has on it, is blue enamel, and as well as the tailpiece. So it's all original except for the truss rod cover. His wife had also made a hand-embroidered cloth, a cleaning cloth and cover cloth to go inside the case. The Ferdinand came in his original case. The case survived 100 years as well. The handle, obviously the leather, didn't last 100 years, but the case is absolutely in great condition as well. Yeah, the Lloyd Loar mandolin is considered to be kind of like the Stradivarius of the mandolin world. They were made from 1922 to 1924, and they don't know the exact numbers. Some people say 240 or 250, some were made to possibly 300. And so in existence, the last time I checked on the mandolin archives, there were 248 that were published in the archive known to exist. So this one's not in the archive. The serial number before it is in the archive, the serial number after it, but this one's been missing all these years. So it's not in the mandolin archive. And so this would be 249. And they're super rare because Lloyd Loar was a luthier who basically came up with the F-5 style mandolin, and a lot of people say they perfected it then. So between 1922 and 24, they were building these extremely ornate, expensive, rare Gibson mandolins, and they're just absolutely beautiful. The sound of them, it's super clear. They're really sought after. They're the most valuable instrument in the mandolin world, and it's a rare bird. How I ended up being connected with the mandolin is a pretty wild story. I ended up in 2017 playing in a festival in Ogden, Utah with Balsam Range, the bluegrass band I play with. And I met through a mutual friend of mine who lives in Montana named Mike Green. I met his friends Dave and Julie. And Dave had came to the festival he was there with Mike, and backstage, the Steep Canyon Rangers were playing there the same day Balsam Range was playing. And Mike Eugenio had his Lloyd Loar mandolin. Having a Lloyd Loar mandolin for me was always a pipe dream. I never dreamed of owning such an instrument. But whenever one's around, it's really cool to see. So Mike Green also knows Mike Eugenio from our Western North Carolina ties. So we're in Ogden, Utah, and Dave and Mike and Mike Eugenio and myself are backstage checking out this mandolin, and Mike Green tells his friend Dave, he says, "This is an extremely rare mandolin. This is a Loyd Loar, and it's very sought after. It's kind of like the Stradivarius of mandolins." And so Dave's, you know, for most people, that information would have been like, okay, whatever, in one ear and out the other. But Dave encyclopedically kind of just filed it away in his brain. In 2018, I went to Montana on vacation with my son, and we played a couple little gigs out there. And this Dave guy had came up from Utah. It's about 4 hours from that spot in Montana, and was just hanging out that week. They came to both shows. We went to some cookouts together, but he saw me play the mandolin and became interested in the mandolin. So he left, went back to Utah, and goes into a local music store a little while later. And he asked the guy in the music store, he said, "I'm looking for a mandolin." And the fellow in the music store said, "Do you want a cheap one or a really, really expensive one?" And Dave says, "Well, I just want a cheap one. But what do you mean, expensive one?" And he said, "Well, I'm not selling it through the store, but I own a Loyd Loar. It's been in my family for a long time. And I've acquired this mandolin, and I'm interested in selling it." And Dave said, "Well, I'm not interested in buying that, but I know a guy who could be." So he reached out to me through social media and said, "Hey, would you be interested in this mandolin?" And I was, of course, you know, being a mandolin guy, I'm always interested in looking at things like that. It's kind of a far-off pipe dream to own one, but I ended up getting connected with a guy. He sent me a bunch of pictures of it, and the mandolin was absolutely ornate and immaculate condition. And I'm looking at the pictures, and it almost looked too good to be true. And so I reach out to the guy. We start having conversations, and there were a lot of things going on in my personal life at the time. And at the time, I tried to make the deal happen, but it just, for whatever reason, we couldn't hook up on the deal, couldn't make it happen. And I basically forgot about it. And so the communication stopped, and that was in early 2020. And fast forward to January of 2022, I had a friend send me an email out of the blue, and who lives in Texas, who found a Loyd Loar mandolin in Florida. And he said, "Hey, is this the real deal? These Loyd Loars, they're still quite sought after, correct?" And I said, "Yeah, they are. It's an interesting, they're extremely rare." But the mandolin was not in very good shape. And I remember looking at it and just thought, "Hey, I wonder if that guy is still out in Utah and has that really immaculate Loyd Loar mandolin." And so I reached out to him just out of the blue and said, "Hey, do you still have that mandolin? Still have it for sale?" And man, he did. That's crazy. And he'd had it for sale, you know, this whole time. And the mandolin should have sold 50 times before I bought it. And why it didn't sell, I will never know. And I think it was a God moment. I think it was meant. A bunch of things had to line up a certain way for me to find it. And a bunch of things had, but one, they had to happen. And then a lot of things had to not happen for me to end up with this. So I think it's a total, they say, you don't find the instrument finds you. And I think that's the case with Ferdinand. I purchased Ferdinand from the great grandson of the original owner. And it had been passed down to him from his grandmother, which was Ferdinand's daughter. And he'd had this mandolin, had it for sale for a while. And he didn't play the mandolin, and he wanted to share the mandolin with the world. He wanted a musician to have it as opposed to just some collector. And that's why he held out, and that's why I ended up with it. So I want to make some music with it. Owning an instrument like Ferdinand, it's an honor. I mean, one, it's it's engineering masterpiece, work of art from a luthier instrument standpoint. It's a piece of history. It's a piece of musical history. And it's to have something like this, there's a kind of a folklore that goes along with it. Sometimes an instrument like J.D. Crow with his banjo, you know, a lot of people knew J.D. Crow, but when he got that pre-war banjo, the instrument made him more famous than he already was. People associated him with this old instrument. And that's because these really rare instruments are, it's almost like a ghost story. You know, there's a, and myths, people are just intrigued because they're so rare. A lot of them got lost in fires and floods and got destroyed over the years. And when they make it and survive 100 years and they're still this masterpiece of engineering from the, you know, the turn of the century, there's that part of it. But then there's also the, now I've got this amazing instrument that I can keep carrying the music forward with, and that's what I want to do. Ferdinand has been laying under the bed for basically a century and not being played. I want to get him out in front of people and share the music, share him, and make people happy. It's time to party.